Hi, I'm JC Pohl from Teen Truth. I am here with Dr. Strixrud from the book, The Self-Driven Child. We are here for a little bonus round. He has agreed to sit with us for just a few more minutes. You know, at Teen Truth, we're all about empowering student voice and building resilient students, but there are just so many obstacles right now that kids are dealing with that stop them from being self-driven or stop them from being resilient. And two of those things, Dr. Strixrud, that have just been top of conversation here in our country for the last few years has obviously been screens. That's been number one. We'll get to number two here in a minute, but just coming out of COVID, coming out of remote learning with iPhones and iPads and gaming consoles and just everything around students these days. How do we build a self-driven child that might be struggling with tech addiction or just struggling with the constant distraction that screens bring into their life?
Okay. So The perspective that my co-author Ned Johnson and I have on this, both the self-driven child and in our new book, is that we can be most helpful if we set a healthy using technology in a healthy way as a family goal. I mean, it's most adults have trouble setting limits on their use of technology. And how many adults do we know where the kids say, "I try to get my parents' attention, but they're always on their phone." That we set it, we set that goal as a family. And regarding games, we try to be respectful. And the people who study this stuff say, well, the best thing to do is to really try to find out about the kids, the games the kids are playing. Try to understand them. Ideally play the games with them, because then you can say, "God, I can see why you love this. I could see why it'd be hard to stop." And then, so part of that message is you start with empathy and understanding, that kind of seek first to understand. Because what happens with a lot of kids is the energy that they get from their parents is no, get off. We're much better able to influence our kids and help them make healthy decisions for themselves and have that kind of, if we try to understand what they're doing. And then we have conversation with them over time. And we say things like, you know, I love the fact that you get so much pleasure from this game. And I love the fact that you get really engrossed in it and you get better and better and better. And I love the fact that playing these games actually has certain kind of cognitive advantages. At the same time, all this evidence suggests if you spend too much time on it, it's just not good for you. So I couldn't live with myself as your parent if I let you, you know, play hours and hours. So Ned and I talk a lot about collaborative problem solving. So let's think about this together. Let's think about how a schedule for you, where the role of gaming in your schedule, so that I'm not against your gaming. It's just that I want you to have time for exercise, sleep, getting your schoolwork done, and let's think about it like that.
And what I love about, you know, everything that shines through in your book is that it's about the student kind of having a seat at the table, right? Like they have some agency and ownership in the conversation about
it. Completely. I mean, the last thing you want is to send a kid off to college who hasn't had any experience trying to manage his own technology. I mean, we're parents, you know, turn off the internet at 10:30 or something. And I want kids to struggle with, because how many adults? And certainly we do think that there are kids, a fairly small percentage, like around 10%, who really develop addictive relationship with games. And we think that those kids need treatment. But I think that one of the experts that we cite in our new book, Devorah Heitner, uses the phrase, we should mentor more than monitor. You know, that we want to be teaching kids and respectfully, treating their love for tech respectfully. And what I tell kids is that, one of the things I tell kids is that in 2018, there was a letter written to the president of the American Psychological Association that was signed by 200 psychologists asking them to censure psychologists working in Silicon Valley knowingly creating these products for children that are as addictive as possible. Mm-hmm. And I want kids to know kind of this is what we're up against. And some of the smartest psychologists in the world are trying to make this impossible for you to stop.
So arming them with information. And then the other thing I liked about what you said earlier is this really is about a family goal. So it's about modeling and kind of making them, it's an issue that's inclusive of the household. And it's interesting, in my therapy practice, I've worked with clients where they bring the teenager in because they got an addiction to technology, right? And what I end up finding out 5 or 6 sessions in is it's not really about technology. It's about their relationship with you, right? And how well they're connecting with you. And it's the technology is there kind of because they don't have that relationship or because they're bored almost, right? And so for us as parents, just to realize the role that we have in the equation.
Right, and I just think that you know, I remember this, I've been struck, JC, about how many families I'll talk with where their families say, I'm just constantly, we're fighting every night, I'm trying to get him into bed. Mm-hmm. And I say, how do you sleep? Oh, I have terrible insomnia. Yeah, well, let's make getting well rested a family. Let's support each other to get enough well rested, as opposed to having this big nightly fight. You know, one of the parents, we gave a lecture about our book a few years ago, 3 years ago when it came out. Mother said, you know, my kids are like 10 and 14. All I do is I print out their screen time for the week and I put the printout on their bed, and I say, I know you're intelligent. I know you want to make your life work. Here's some data that may help you make a decision for the next week. Mm. That I'm not saying that works for everybody,
right?
But I love that respectful approach.
Giving them some information. And then so real quickly, I know this is just a bonus video, so we'll try to keep it short here.
Yeah.
But you know, here in America, there's just been so much talk about equality and equity and education, and just making sure that every student on our campuses have the right opportunities. And so, you know, we've done 3 videos here in this series. We've talked about the importance of the self-driven child, this idea of being a consultant. You've done such a good job, Dr. Strixrud, kind of breaking down some of these case studies and just strategies that we can use to approach students. And so I just want to layer on for a minute, just this kind of cultural and ethnic conversation, social conversation that's been happening in our country the last few years. Like, how does the idea of equity in the classroom, kind of like play into this conversation about self-driven children, in the sense that some kids may not have some of those supports or have the parents that can always have those conversations with them at home.
Right. And so I think that one of the things we wrote a special introduction to this self-driven child for the Chinese language version. And part of the reason part of what we said is that a lot of the research that we point to that shows how important a sense of control on is based on it's done on animals, you know. If you have a mammalian brain, no matter what your race or ethnic background, the idea is that this sense of control. If you have a healthy sense of control over your own life, it basically inoculates you from the harmful effects of stress. And it doesn't matter where you're from, ethnicity doesn't matter. And so I think that the basic principles of the self-driven child apply across, because they have to do with, if you have a human nervous system and you don't sleep, you're gonna have a low sense of control. If you're chronically stressed, it's gonna affect your brain in a way that it's not gonna help you. You're gonna diminish your sense of control. And if you diminish sense of control, you're gonna have more anxiety, you're gonna have more stress, you're gonna be more vulnerable to depression, you're not gonna be self-motivated, that kind. So I think the principles apply across. I think that there's certainly some of the things that we worry about, for example, the Hermione Grangers, these really high achieving kids in high achieving schools. I mean, where the worst worry they have is getting into having to go to Wisconsin as opposed to Yale.
Yeah.
Very different concerns, and certainly people of color oftentimes have the sense that my kid has to understand that the way we equalize things for you is you go to the most elite college possible. You got to get into an elite college. And many kids of color feel in education, get the message that they really need to work harder than everybody else. And it's more important for them. And and my response to that is that we want kids to have an accurate model of reality. And certainly there are advantages to going to elite schools. But one of the most disempowering messages we can give a kid is that you have to do this, because kid's not capable of it, then he's telling himself, I have to, but I can't. I have to, but I can't. And so we want to be careful about that. And certainly kids in disadvantaged communities, I mean, these principles, what we tend to do a lot, we use a lot of external reinforcement. We use a lot of rewards and punishment that undermine that intrinsic motivation.
And so, and I'm sure it's just like you've talked about so well in our time together, it's just, it's always probably collaborative too, like pulling the student into the conversation, helping them find some of the solutions that work for them so they can build their own pathway forward. And so Dr. Strixrud, I just can't thank you enough for the time that you've spent with us today. I'm sure our audience is just eating up the information, and I just thank you so much. Again, the name of the book is A Self-Driven Child. I've got a bunch of copies here in the office that I love to give to our clients. I refer to it all the time. And I just wish you and Ned the best in your work, and I hope our paths get to cross again.
Well, I love your energy, JC, and we're very grateful for your support of our work, and keep up the great work you're doing.
Yeah, definitely. If you want to learn more about Teen Truth, check us out at teentruth.net, or of course, find us out on social media. Y'all take care. You have a great day.